Welcome to Season 3 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, we are catching up with experts involved in the Novel Coronavirus Research Compendium, the website that tracks new studies about the pandemic. First, we'll hear from Dr. Cherie Schwartz of the School of Public Health at Johns Hopkins about a preprint study of a healthcare worker who experienced COVID-19 twice. Then we'll hear from Dr. Nicholas Wada about a study published in the journal Science explaining why some people, particularly men, might experience more severe COVID disease. Finally, we'll hear from Dr. Ashwin Balagopal of the School of Medicine at Johns Hopkins about a study published in the Lancet Respiratory Medicine of a clinical trial of inhaled interferon with promising results. You can read more about these and other studies at ncrc.jhsph.edu. That's ncrc.jhsph.edu. Let's listen. Dr. Schwartz, thanks for joining me again on the podcast. Tell me about the paper you're looking at this week. What is it addressing?
Hi, Josh. Thanks for having me. Today, I'm going to be talking about the topic of reinfection.
Meaning reinfection with COVID.
Yes, reinfection with COVID.
So what's the paper?
So the paper is a preprint coming from Belgium, and it's about a healthcare worker. So this was a young, relatively healthy woman, and she was first infected with the coronavirus in March of this year. She had a relatively mild case, but it was prolonged, you know, the sort of the typical cough, malaise, headache, fever. She was off from work for a month, but never hospitalized. And then in September of this year, she had a second case. And this was a milder case. She was only out for about 10 days this time. But it was a part of a cluster of cases in the hospital. And this case was particularly interesting because it actually looks like she was able to infect other patients.
So there is a healthcare worker who gets infected in March and again in September. The good news for her is that she doesn't get that sick in September, but the concerning news is she does have the ability, it seems, to pass the virus on to other people.
Yes, and there have been 26 so far confirmed cases of reinfection, and there's many, many more that are suspected. But you have to remember, it's really difficult to confirm a case of reinfection because you need to have samples of sequencing from the first infection, and then again from the second infection to actually be able to tell that indeed this is a different variant of the virus and not just the same persistent infection that's coming back, right?
And that's what they did in this case. They did two different viral tests and they showed that it were two different strains of the virus.
Yes, that's what they were able to show in this case. And in the second case, they also did that testing amongst the other hospital patients so that they could see that they were all genetically linked in terms of the virus that they were infected with.
Is it possible that she never mounted an immune response to the virus the first time and that's why she was susceptible the second time?
So this was another really important thing about this case. So each of these reinfection stories helps us learn something new. And in this case, they actually had taken a sample from her 3 months after her first infection. And we could see that she actually did develop a neutralizing antibody response. So it looked like her immune system was developing a response, which is good. That's what you want. What we don't have are data right before, you know, any samples from right before she was reinfected. So we don't know if those antibodies waned or if she still had those neutralizing antibodies and they still weren't protective enough. That we can't say. But we do know that she did develop an immune response.
So these cases, you said there are 26 of them known now, but probably more. These cases illustrate perhaps that we don't know exactly how long immunity may last for COVID-19. Would that be fair?
Yeah, I think that's fair to say. And, you know, this case is important because we know that she did develop the immune response. But again, yeah, you're right. We don't know how long that lasts. And of course, that may have implications for herd immunity. It could have implications for vaccines. So it's important for us to continue to explore these case studies.
One of those implications might be the need for booster doses, for example.
Absolutely.
Great. Well, thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks, Josh.
Dr. Wada, thank you so much for joining me. What's your paper about?
Hey, thanks so much for having me. So one of the frustrating mysteries about the pandemic has been why there's such strong variation in the clinical response. In other words, why do some people get so sick while others don't? And we know that there are certain risk factors underlying severe disease, like men tend to get sicker than women, older age is associated with more severe disease, but that doesn't explain why some people get really sick and require ICU admission, say, while others hardly experience any symptoms at all.
So what's the factor that this paper explores?
So they're interested in the hypothesis that perhaps it's a variation in our immune response that may partially explain some of these differences. And they looked at one specific hypothesis that severe disease might be caused when one part of the immune system actually attacks another part of the immune system.
So COVID is somehow getting the immune system to attack another part of the immune system?
Actually, it's not. It doesn't appear that it's COVID that's causing the problem. It appears that some people have an underlying condition where their immune systems produce antibodies. And we think of antibodies as neutralizing pathogens that come from outside the body, but some people produce antibodies by accident that attack elements of their own bodies. These are called autoantibodies. And the researchers here were interested in looking at the hypothesis that patients with severe COVID-19 pneumonia might be producing autoantibodies to a crucial part of our antiviral immune response called the type 1 interferon response. And type 1 interferons are a kind of immune signaling chemical called cytokines that do the really important job of alerting other elements of the immune system, sounding the alarm, organizing and mobilizing a response.
So some people naturally have antibodies against these interferons?
They do. And in fact, the researchers' attention was drawn to this when they saw three patients who had an autoimmune disorder that caused them to produce autoantibodies to type 1 interferons. And they all developed severe COVID-19 pneumonia. So they wanted to see how common this was. So they looked at a large group of nearly 1,000 patients with life-threatening COVID pneumonia, and they looked for these autoantibodies, and they compared the rates that they found to about 600 or 700 people who had mild or asymptomatic COVID infection, and then over 1,000 samples that were taken from before the pandemic.
And what'd they find?
Interestingly, they found that about 10% of people with severe COVID had neutralizing antibodies to type 1 interferons, while nobody had them in the 600 mild cases, and only 0.3% had them in the general population of healthy controls back before the pandemic. And really interestingly, nearly all of them were men, over 90%.
So this may be one reason why certain people, in particular, certain men, get very sick from COVID.
Yeah, it's long been puzzling why men seem to get sicker than women do. And some explanations that have been offered involve behavioral factors, smoking, even mask wearing, minimizing the viral load that they inhale initially. But this is the first study to suggest that it's part of the immune response. And in fact, there's evidence that this may be an X chromosome linked mutation that causes the production of these autoantibodies. They only had two samples among the sick patients that were taken before infection. But in those two patients, the autoantibodies were present before the infection. So this, along with other lines of evidence, suggests that this is a cause of and not a consequence of severe COVID.
So someday it may be possible to know whether you have this particular risk for getting severe COVID.
That's true. In fact, they're already doing some screening for it in the hospitals where this research was conducted. And the author suggests that screening for these autoantibodies should be routine. And it may even lead to treatment down the line, provision of other interferons that aren't neutralized by these autoantibodies, for example. And this is probably just the tip of the iceberg. There may be other important variations in the immune response that haven't been detected yet or haven't been tested for yet.
Great. Well, thanks so much for explaining that.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Dr. Balagopal, thanks so much for joining me. Now, I've heard a rumor that your paper is also in some way about interferon. Is that true?
That's correct. Yeah.
So tell me what this paper is about.
So this is a report of a doubly blinded randomized controlled trial of an inhaled interferon compound called SNG-001. It's also related to the type 1 interferons. It was administered in a clinical trial against a placebo group in 100 people. And among those people who were followed for clinical outcomes, it appeared that the type 1 interferon allowed quicker recovery in the people who received it.
So we're talking about patients with COVID-19.
That's correct.
And half of them, or some percentage of them, were randomly given this inhaled interferon.
That's correct.
And interferon refers to, you know, a family of compounds. Is that fair to say?
It's a family of compounds. It's been used in many other viral diseases prior to this. It's a general antiviral that boosts the immune system to produce endogenous or internal antiviral factors that then fight a viral infection.
Got it. And this is one member of the family that they're giving.
This is one member of the family formulated in a way that is that allows it to be administered to people.
Right. And goes right to the lungs.
It's inhaled. That's correct. It goes straight to the lungs.
So give me a sense of how well the patients who turned out to get the treatment versus the placebo actually did in the study. Was it a significant improvement?
It appeared that people who received the compound were more than two times likely than the people who received placebo to improve according to a clinical scale set by the WHO.
That might be like their oxygenation or things like that went into the clinical scale.
It was all related to how severe their disease was as determined by clinical grading. So did they require a ventilator? Did they require oxygen? Did they recover fully from all of their symptoms? These were all tabulated for all of the participants.
Was it able to say whether it reduced the chance someone might die of COVID?
There were only three people who died in the entire study. All of them received the placebo. So I don't think it had enough power to really describe mortality benefit well.
I see, but maybe.
Perhaps. I think it's a small study, so it's hard to say.
So you put this together with the study that we heard from Dr. Wada, that people who have antibodies against interferons may actually do worse. Here, what you're saying is there's evidence that if people get this one kind of interferon, they might do better. What does that suggest?
Well, it suggests that type 1 interferons are either important or critical at controlling the disease caused by the SARS-CoV-2 virus. And we suspected that for some time. It will need further confirmation. But it at least tells us that this is part of the causal pathway of controlling the virus, at least early, although there are questions about its role later on in people who have two or more weeks of disease.
Sounds like we're learning more and more about the important role of our immunological system in determining how we do when we get COVID-19.
These studies are certainly complementary in that they highlight a part of our immune system that may be critical to control early replication of this deadly virus.
Great. Well, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.